to worship at Trinity United Church. Happy Victoria Day weekend to you all. And it's certainly spring, the lilacs are out. What a joy. How many of you have lilacs in your garden? And how many of you have done some and brought them inside because the smell is so glorious? Oh, I know. They're just marvelous. They're just marvelous. Well, it's good to see you all, and it's wonderful to be. Is there anything the choir needs to say? Because we're what?
We're open.
Pardon? Welcome to worship. There is a sheet of announcements in your bulletin, and I draw them to your attention. The next week is pre. I was a music teacher for a very long time and a conductor. I know how to give you the eye. No, it does not.
We're too old.
Next week is Presentation Sunday for the youngsters in the Sunday school. And that's an important day. And the following week is our anniversary service on June the 4th. And there'll be a fellowship potluck after that, which is I'm really looking forward to. And just a couple of days after that, the Frontenac Youth Choir concert is there. There's a couple of other things that are marked here. I've got a lot of competition today. Who wants to preach? I commend these to your attention. Are there any other announcements that I haven't got here that we need to make? John, anything? No? All right, fair enough.
Love it.
Then I guess that we are ready to begin our worship with our introit. It is in More Voices, and I hope you all have copies of More Voices in your pews. The choir is going to sing one verse, and then I'm hoping that you will join us as we sing it a second time. Gather us in More Voices number 7.
Thank you.
lighting the Christ candle. We gather as people who follow the light.
Jesus said, I am the light of the world.
Our call to worship, read responsibly, come to this place with open minds and open hearts.
We leave our judgments at the door and open ourselves to God's Spirit.
This is a place where we look deep within ourselves.
Prepare to let the Spirit shape us into the people God calls us to be.
With every whisper of God, we are transformed.
Let us worship God as we come together.
And our opening prayer in unison. We are here to worship you, O God. Your resurrection people are here to sing your praises and crown you, the ascended one.
You know our struggles in this world. We ask that you forgive our petty concerns and missteps. Help us to embody your love to all the world, now and forever. Open our understanding and lead us to repentance, that you may be our God on earth as in heaven. Amen.
When we move forward on the right paths, we follow in God's way. As we journey together, we know that we are not alone. We travel in God's love. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 330. Or is it 339? I'm throwing my glasses. Yep, 339.
Yeah, 339.
Yeah, that's it. Yes. In your red hymn books, When Morning Gilds the Skies, we'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4, and I invite you to stand in body or in spirit.
Thank you.
join me on the steps, or are you happy where you are? That's what I thought. Open up. As the choir moves down, my question today is this. What makes you feel safe? Jocelyn.
My family.
Your family. Okay. Anything else? Does having a fence around your garden, your yard, help make you feel safe so that the bugaboos can't get in? Hmm? Not really? Carmen?
Flashlight in the dark.
Oh, that's a good one. Oh, I like that. I like that. Anything else?
Paramedics and fire department.
Okay, paramedics and fire department. Yeah, pretty amazing folks. If we want to feel safe, how do we manage if we're walking a path and we're not necessarily looking where we're walking? What happens if there's a great big hole and you fall in? You call the paramedics. Right. Or if it's in the dark, you probably should have had a flashlight. Or you probably should have listened to your family and stayed home. All of those things. I'm thinking about how we manage to feel safe going from one place to another place. And the difference between where we is now and where we might find ourselves in the next moments. And if that sounds confusing, it kind of is. But that's what I'm going to be talking about in my message. So stay tuned. Let's join together in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
And I guess the whole Sunday school crew is on their way downstairs.
Place where we have the dedication of our offerings. It's good to give. It's especially good to give to the Lord. Please join me as we remain seated and sing from VU Voices United, number 540. Our hymn is found in Voices United, number 334. All hail the power of Jesus' name, and we will be singing verses 1, 3, and 4. Scripture reading this morning is found in the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 6 through 11, and it's dealing with the ascension of Jesus. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and the cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by him in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Ralph. Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking? looking up toward heaven. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of us all. Amen. One of my favorite things about travel in the United Kingdom is the automated voice telling me to mind the gap as I get on and off the train. I like to think that somewhere, somehow, someone is looking out for me and hopes that I am actually paying attention so I won't fall into some sort of hole or space without looking. Today's scripture is about minding the gap. Perhaps I ought to explain. So, 1 minute, Jesus was standing with and talking to his apostles. He was right there. The apostles can see him. They can hear his voice, and if they'd reached out, they could have touched him. The next minute, quote, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. It's as if they were watching a gap open between him and then, between the seen and the unseen, between their lives as they have been and as they were now. Now, I don't specifically know why the apostles standing looking up towards heaven. I don't know why they were doing it, except it was something interesting to look at. But they don't answer the two men in the white robes who ask them, why are you looking? And they don't answer them. But I can tell you about the many times that I have stood looking up towards heaven. And I have an idea that it might be why the apostles were doing it at that moment. The times I've stood looking up towards heaven were times when a gap was opening in my life. When I feel the tension of the gap, I look up to heaven. And when I feel pulled between this and that, I look up to heaven. Sometimes the gap feels like an ever-widening chasm that I will never be able to bridge or cross. Other times it feels like an abyss, you know, a great hole into which I'm falling and that I'll never, ever get out of. Sometimes that gap is about a longing and a desire for something new, something different, something more, or something less. And other times that gap is about pain and loss and heartbreak. Does any of that sound familiar? Yeah. Do you recall when you've been looking up towards heaven and what was going on? I remember the gap between being divorced and wanting a deep and meaningful relationship. I felt the gap open the day I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, and I knew that my life would never, ever be like it once was. I remember the day my husband went off as a peacekeeper to the former Yugoslavia, and feeling the gap between wanting to hold on to him and my joy and my pride in why he was going. It seems that there's always a gap between the pain and the hurt in this world and other people's lives and my prayers for God's justice and healing and comfort and peace. For many years, I lived with the gap between being a musician and being pulled into ordered ministry. And now as a preacher, I feel the gap between my faithfulness to the gospel and my wanting to be liked and approved of. The experience that I have, again, of the gap between my life as it is and as I would have it be. And I see the gap between the woman I am and the woman I would like to be. Most recently, I felt the gap between enjoying in-person worship and yet wanting everyone to stay safe and healthy. I feel the gap between wanting to be close and yet not wanting to endanger anyone, myself, or be endangered in some way. Because I feel the gap between what I know, or what I think I know, about COVID-19 and all the new viruses, and all that I don't know. Those are a few of the gaps in my life. Think about yours, if you would. What gaps are in your life today? In what ways do you feel pulled or torn between two realities? What chasm or abyss are you dealing with today? At some point, we all come to a gap in our life. It takes us to the edge of what we know, to the border of what we believe, to the horizon of what we can see, to the limit of our self-sufficiency. And that gap's a paradox. Great word, paradox. Because this gap looks like two opposing edges, and it feels like we're being pulled in two different directions. But paradoxes, being the puzzles that they are, remind us that there's always more there than what we can see. And it's in those moments that I look up towards heaven. And I want God to fill and close the gap, because I know darn well that I cannot. Maybe that's why the apostles were looking up towards heaven. Maybe they too wanted a God of the gaps, a God who would fill and close the gap that they were experiencing as Jesus ascended into heaven. One minute he's here, and the next he's gone. But what if God does not fill or close the gaps in our life? What if instead God calls us to stand in the gap? What if we are the ones to fill the gap with God's presence through our faith and our hope and our love, through mercy and compassion, tenderness, hospitality, justice, goodness? And what would that mean for the gaps in your life and my life as people of faith? And what the futures of your families and your friends or your church might be? How might you stand in the gap? More and more, I am coming to see that Jesus' physical withdrawal from this world is less about his absence and more about our presence. Less about his absence that we can see, and more about our parent teaching a child to walk. At first, the parent stands over the child holding his or her hands. And then a parent faces the child and shuffles backwards while holding the child's hands. But at some point, mom or dad let go of that child's hand and back up and withdraw. And to the child, it looks like distance or absence. But to the parent, it's a calling. It's an invitation for the child to step forward and fill the gap between them. Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? I don't believe that that's a question to be answered. Rather, it's a call to fill the gap. Stepping into a gap will not resolve the tensions we feel, being pulled from one place to another and being in between. What it does is it lets us hold those tensions. That's what Jesus did with the gaps in his life. Remember when he was 12 years old and Mary and Joseph thought he was lost, but he'd stayed in Jerusalem and was hanging out in the synagogue? He was holding the tension of the gap between his life in their house and his life in his father's house. When the Syrophoenician woman asked him to heal her daughter, he confronted a gap in his identity and his mission. He held the tension between the children of Israel and the one he referred to as a dog. The Garden of Gethsemane was a gap experience in which he held the tension between his will and his father's will. And maybe the most graphic image of all of the gap in Jesus' life was the crucifixion. Jesus pulled between heaven and earth, arms outstretched, embracing the world, praying to the Father by whom he was feeling forsaken in that very human moment. Jesus never sidestepped the gaps in his life. He always held that tension. To stand in a gap doesn't fix anything, but it changes everything. Whether it's that sweet ache of longing and desire for what we want most, or the bitterness of a heartache we never wanted or asked for, gaps are not just openings in our lives. They open us to something new, and they open something new within us. Gaps offer possibilities of transformation for ourselves, for others, for our churches, for the world. Whatever the gaps of your life and my life might be today, we have a choice to make. We can keep looking upward towards heaven, towards what is unseen and intangible, or we can turn our eyes to the neighbor who's visible and reach out our hands to the circumstances that are tangible, that are real, and step into that gap. I want Trinity United Church to make a difference. I want this church to stand in the gap and be a public face of Christ to the world. And so, beloved, mind the gap. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God of possibilities, be with us as we journey the road ahead with you. Amen. As we come into a time of prayer, I invite you to remain seated as we sing number 948 in our hymn books. Number 948. You have asked us to live out our resurrection faith in service, offering peace and justice, hope and healing to all whom we meet. It is easy for us to lift the names of those near and dear to us in prayer in our worship service. And we want your healing mercies for all who are ill, who mourn, who feel lost and alone. We want to rejoice in prayer with those who have received special joys during this week. There are so many places in this world that are hurting. We think of Alberta and the fires, continuing war in Ukraine, the shooting close to us up in Renfrew. All these things are important to us, and we know they are important to you, O God. Help us to live the prayers we ask. Help us to be agents of healing and mercy, of growth and transformation, of peace and hope. We offer our lives and our prayers to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn is a familiar one. I invite you to stand in body or in spirit as we sing number 337 in our hymn books, Blessed Assurance.
Thank you.
washed in Christ's love. We have been washed in Christ's love, have we not, during our time of worship. I see and feel the Spirit moving between the notes we sing and the words we speak, the prayers of our hearts and our minds, the love we feel for one another, the care we have for one another. All those things are filling the gap. That invitation from Jesus, from God, to bridge any distance there might be between God's love and anyone else. People have asked me, but where is God? Is God in you or me? And I said, no, God's right here, in between. Let us go from this place of worship, knowing that our time of worship may have finished, but our time of ministry begins. Go knowing the love of God. Go knowing the love and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Go knowing the beauty, the energy, the mystery of the Holy Spirit working in all of our lives. Go knowing who you are. Go knowing to whom you belong. And let us sing a benediction of peace to one another. You may not even need the words anymore, but they are in the bulletin. Take it away.